tourist Mecca par excellence, the Colosseum has stood for almost 2,000 years. Built between 70 and 80 AD by Emperor Vespasian, the Flavian amphitheater, as it was named, was the largest of its type, seating anywhere between 55 and 75,000 spectators. What did they come to see in that magnificent structure? Death and violence. Animals hunted by humans or each other in the morning, public executions at the midday, and gladiators, hard-fighting men, killing in the evening. For 450 years, Romans flocked to the site as the empire exploited their basest instincts to keep them satiated and subdued. Hi, I'm Liz Lev, and I'm an art historian, and you're listening to the podcast From Tourists to Pilgrims. Christianity first took root in this blood-soaked society, spreading a message of peace to a people who found entertainment in violence must have seemed like a bit of a losing proposition. Christian blood is at the very foundation of this building, for this site was specifically chosen by Emperor Vespasian because it was the core of Emperor Nero's outrageous golden house, the Domus Aurea. The land all around the building was cleared under Emperor Nero in 64 AD by one of the most devastating fires in the history of Rome. A fire, if not set, then exploited by Emperor Nero to obtain a vast area of land to build a new exorbitant residence. The site of the Colosseum itself was where he placed his most offensive feature, an enormous artificial lake to simulate the Mediterranean in the heart of downtown Rome. When outraged Romans protested, accusing Nero of having set the fire in the first place, the emperor found an easy scapegoat in the Christian community and rounded up several hundred for public punishment. Among those killed was Saint Peter, accused of a crime he did not commit. The mad Nero was replaced by the calculating Vespasian, who constructed an amphitheater to direct the bloodlust of the Romans towards beasts, slaves, and criminals, all the same in the eyes of Roman officials. It's hard to imagine why Christians, once the Roman Empire had fallen, would have had anything to do with this building. And indeed, for many years, it suffered neglect. The colossal bronze statue of Nero outside collapsed during a 9th century earthquake. The southern wall crumbled after the earthquake of 1349. And the papacy began to see some use for the building after all, quarrying the fallen stones to make new, beautiful churches. But the 15th century also saw the Colosseum identified as a place of historical suffering, and pious Romans began to perform passion plays in its space. Shortly afterwards, the Stations of the Cross were done. This custom is still continued today by the present pontiff. As pilgrims began to swell the ranks of the populace, the Colosseum slowly grew into a place of remembrance of suffering, of all those killed in the horrific games of the amphitheater, whether consumed by animals or eviscerated by gladiators. The collective suffering was best expressed through recalling the last hours of Christ's life as he carried the cross to his own unjust execution. The papacy began to invest in preserving the space despite its wicked origins. Declared a martyrium in the 1750s, the building was protected from any further destruction. And by 1815, restorations were underway, resulting in those two diagonal wings that support Rome's greatest and most lucrative tourist attraction today. Inside the unexcavated floor, supported travertine stations around the ring of the arena, and in the center stood a large cross. In 1650, a pilgrim returning from the Holy Land painted an image of Jerusalem over the western entrance. An accurate view of the city, complete with the representation of Christ's crucifixion outside its walls. A tiny shrine tucked in the southeast corner of the stands was probably there as early as the 7th century. But by the 16th century, it had become an oratorio, Madonna della Pietà, Our Lady of Mercy. It's invisible to tourists today, but it was once the meta of pilgrims who in the 18th century would have seen a ragged figure who lived in the ruins. The grand tourists would have taken him for another pitiable beggar, but pilgrims discovered that he was a holy man, beloved by Romans, Benedict Joseph Labre. He was canonized a century after his death at age 35 in 1783, and he is the patron saint of the homeless. The unification of Italy ripped out all the Christian elements of the Colosseum, even as the Pope was exiled into the walls of the Vatican. But now, 150 years later, a bronze cross has returned, one of the stations of the cross has been replaced, and the city every year eagerly awaits the Pope's arrival on Good Friday. The greatest lesson of the Colosseum is not how human beings can be seduced by the mob's love of violence, but that the message of Christ's peace has a continuing power to persuade and transform over centuries.
You've been listening to From Tourist to Pilgrim, a podcast written and narrated by Liz Lev, produced by Johanna Bronkova and Mara Micheli.